Hello everyone, welcome to getlectures.com. Today the topic which we are going to discuss is transactions and concurrency control. So today we will see what is recoverability, what is serializability, and how to ensure recoverability and serializability through the concurrency control protocols. Okay, so in concurrency control protocols we will see two-phase locking protocols, timestamping protocols, and the deadlock problem. In transactions we will see serializability and recoverability. Okay, so let's start with transactions. What are the transactions? What do you mean by transaction? So transactions are nothing but set of logically related operations. Okay, set of logical operations which read or write the database. Okay, when you execute these operations, they will do some modification on the database. For example, they will read some data item or they will write some data item. For example, if you look at the transaction, the form of the transaction will be like this. Let's say this is a transaction T and this is doing something read, write in the transaction, in the database. Okay. And after performing all the operations, it will say commit. Commit means it have executed all the operations successfully, and now you can reflect those modifications in the database. Okay, after commit operation means you have successfully executed the operations and there is no rollback. Okay, so on the basis of these operations we have two kind of transactions. One transaction is serial and another kind of transaction is concurrent. Okay, so serial transactions are like this. In serial transaction, let's say you have two transactions T1 and T2. So the operations of T1 and T2 will be in serial way. Okay, there will not be a concurrent operations. For example, in operating system, if you look at the processes are two types, that is independent processes and concurrent processes. Okay, so to handle the concurrent processes we use the process synchronization. In the same way in database management system, to handle the concurrent transactions we use some protocols. Okay, for example, we have this transaction T1 which is performing some operations on the database, that is read A, write A, read B, write B, and after completion of this transaction T1, T2 will start its executing its operations. For example, read A, read B. Okay, so this is complete set of transaction is known as schedule. Okay, this is schedule. So what is the definition of transactions and schedule? Transactions are the collection of operations which when executed on the database will make some modifications, and the schedule is the collection of transactions, and the schedule may be a serial schedule and it may be a concurrent schedule. If you look at this schedule, this is concurrent schedule. Okay, concurrent schedule, why? Because the operations of T1 and T2 are executing in serial manner. Serial manner means first they will execute, first T will complete, then T2 will start. Okay, and then we have concurrent transactions. Concurrent transactions are like this: T1, T2, and first we are executing T1. Okay, while T1 was executing, there is a context switch and T2 starts executing. Okay, we will switch from T1 to T2, then T2 to T1. So they are executing in parallel. Why we can say they are executing in parallel? Because T1 is not executed completely and T2 comes. Okay, so T2 is executing in the middle of T1. So they are concurrent transactions. This is also a schedule, but the difference between these two schedules is this schedule and this schedule. This schedule is actually a serial schedule and this schedule is concurrent schedule. So why we need to use the concurrency control? The problem is this is concurrent transaction. Okay, this is concurrent transaction. So there is no problem with the serial schedule, but there will be a problems in case of concurrent schedules. Okay, for example, if you look at the example, let us say I am transferring some amount to some another account. Okay, so let's say we have a database of bank. And in bank database, what we are doing is we are transferring $50 from account A to account B. Okay, what will be the problem? If you do this process parallelly. Okay. So in case of serial schedule, what will happen is first you will read the balance of account A, then you will subtract $50 from account A, then you will write this final result into account B. Okay. Then B will start, we will read the account of B, account balance of B, and then we will increment the balance of B by 50. Okay, so we have transferred $50 from account A to account B, and then you will write the final balance of B. Okay, so there is no problem with this schedule, this will execute perfectly. Okay, but if you do this operation concurrently, what will happen? Okay, in case of concurrent, for example, let's say the balance of A was initially $500. Okay, initial balance was this. So first what will you do is you will read the account of A, then you will subtract 50 from the account of A, because you are transferring 50 from the account A to account B. Then you will read the account of A. Okay, read the account of A, then equals to A minus 40. And let's say this transaction T1 and this is transaction T2. Okay, they are executing parallelly. And what we are doing is we are transferring $50 to account B, and parallelly another person from the same account is withdrawing 50 rupees, $50. Okay, this is the transaction for transferring $50 to account B, and this is the transaction to withdraw $50 from account A. Okay, so finally it will write the value of A, and then this transaction will start executing, and this will do the write operation on the data item A. Okay, so initially value of A was 500. Then this transaction comes, and then this transaction is not return the final value yet, it will write here. Okay, so T2 comes, it will read A, then it will subtract 50, this will become 450. Okay, then this will write the value of A, that is 450. Okay, so it has written the value A, that is 450, and then this transaction comes, this will modify this value by how many? It will modify the value by 450. Okay, it will make the value 450, because initially value was 500, then you subtracted 500 minus 50, that is 450. The value here was 450 of A. So these two transactions will be having their own registers. On registers, they will be having separate registers. So this A has written its value into the register, and finally it will write this value into the database. Okay. So this transaction has separate register in which it will read the value 500. It will read the fresh value, because you have not written this modification into database yet. You will write here. Okay, so it will pick the initial value 500, and it will subtract 550 from the 500, and it will make it 450. And then it will write the final value. And then a transaction T1 comes, and it will write A into the database, which will make it 450. Okay, there is a problem. Problem is the final value of A should have been 400. Okay, the final value of A should be 400. Why? Because you are transferring $50 plus you are withdrawing $50 from your account. Okay, so there are two things are happening in the same data item. You are subtracting 50 two times. But due to this write update, this is lost update problem. Okay. T2 wrote something into the database, but due to T1, this update was lost. So this is the problem of lost update problem, and final value was 450 due to this write A operation. Okay, so this is the problem with the concurrent transactions. Okay, to handle this problem, we have many protocols. Okay, we will see what are the solutions. So the problem which we just saw was the probability of integrity. Okay, so to maintain integrity, we have to ensure ACID properties. Okay, so we have ACID properties. You must have heard about these ACID properties, ACID properties are just to deal with the concurrent transactions. Okay, there's no problem with the serial execution of the transactions, but there will be problems with the concurrent execution of the transactions. In case of concurrent execution, we will have many problems, read-write problems. Okay, to maintain the integrity in the database, we use ACID properties. Okay, we have to ensure ACID properties. You have any schedule. That schedule will be valid if it is ensuring ACID properties. What is ACID properties? Okay. A means atomicity. Atomicity says either all the operations, should be executed or none. Okay, what it means? For example, you have a transaction in which you have some operations like this. Read A, write A, read B, write B. Okay, so the property atomicity says either all these operations of this transaction should be executed successfully. If there is a failure, let's say at this position there comes a failure, you should roll back this transaction. Okay, you should undo all the operations. You should not commit in the middle. Okay, this means that either all the operations should be executed or none. Okay, you cannot say that I have done these three operations, they should be reflected into the database. You cannot reflect the partial modification into the database. Okay, so if there is a failure at this position, all the operations should be undone. Okay, that is this is known as recoverability. Okay, you should recover this transaction. You should roll back this transaction. So either all the operations should be executed or none should be executed. Okay, take an example. For example, you go to the ATM and you try to withdraw some money. First you will enter the PIN, that is your first operation. Then you will choose withdraw operation, that is your second operation. Then you will enter the PIN and then you will enter the amount. Okay, so you have done four operations on your database, on your bank database, and then there's a failure. Let's say there's a power failure in the ATM machine. So ATM machine goes off. So in this case, you have already entered the amount, which means amount is being deducted from your account. So if the amount is deducted from your account and you have not received the cash, so this is partial transaction. Okay, transaction is partial. So this should be undone. Okay, if it is not rollbacked, what will happen is your account will be deducted with the amount, but you will not get the amount. Okay, because in the middle there is a power failure. So if in this case what bank will do is bank will recover your transaction. It will roll back all the operations of your transaction which you have done, and it will say the transaction never occurred. Okay, it will be like this. Your transaction will never occur. So in the end, it will look like you have not executed this transaction. Okay, so that's why atomicity is saying either all these operations should be executed or none of them should be executed. Okay, so then second property is C, that is consistency. C means consistency. So the consistency says after the execution, of transaction, database should be consistent. Okay, no any transaction should leave the database in the inconsistent state. Okay, after the execution of transaction, database should be consistent. What we mean by consistent? For example, let's say you are transferring $50 from account A to account B. Okay, so let's say initial balance of A was 500 and initial balance of B was, let's say, 400. So after the transfer of amount from $50 from account A to account B, what will be the values of these? Okay, if you look at the sum of these two accounts before the execution of the transaction, it will be 900. Okay, 900 is the summation of account A and account B. Okay, in account A and account B, we have $900. So after the transfer operation, okay, when you transfer $50 from account A to account B, this will become 450. and this will also become 450 because you have transferred $50 from account A to account B. Okay, so if you look at the sum of A, account A and account B after the execution of the transaction, it is 900. Okay, so consistency says it should not happen that after the execution of transaction, the database is inconsistent. Inconsistent means the sum of these two account balance is different from the sum before the execution of the transaction. So if the database was consistent before starting the transaction, it should be consistent after the execution of the transaction. Any transaction should not leave the database in the inconsistent state. Okay, inconsistent means the sum of these two accounts will be different from the initial sum. Okay, because you have transferred $50 from here to here. So sum should be same after the execution of the transaction. Now it will become 450. Okay, if there is a transaction failure, what will happen is we have deducted $50 from account A and we have not transferred this amount to account B. Okay, the amount is being deducted from your account but is not transferred to account B. So in that case, what will happen is the sum of account A and account B will be 450 and 400 because we have deducted $50 from account A but we have not transferred this amount to account B. So this will be inconsistent state. The sum then in that case, if there is a failure, let's say failure is that $50 is being deducted from account A but it is not being transferred to account B. So if there is a failure, the value of account in account A will be 450 and account B will be same, that is 400, because this $50 is not transferred to account B. So the summation is 850, which is different from the initial summation. Okay, this is inconsistent state. Okay, so then third property is isolation. Okay, I means isolation. So isolation means if two transactions are executing parallelly, let's say two transactions are executing concurrently, they should be invisible to each other. Okay, if two transactions are executing concurrently, then the operations of one transaction should be transparent to other. Transparent means the word transparent means the operations of one transaction should not be visible to transaction T2. If we have two transactions T1 and T2, let's say they are executing concurrently, which means we have read operation here, write operation, then T2 comes, it will perform some operations. Okay, then T1 comes back and it will do some write operations. Okay, these two transactions are executing concurrently, but T1 should execute such that it should be executing like that. It is not, it is executing, the transaction is serial. Okay, so T2 will think that only this is the only transaction which is executing, and T1 will think that this is the only transaction which is executing. Okay, we should ensure such isolation in the transactions in the database. Okay, so if T1 is executing, it should not be visible to T2. If T2 is executing, T2 should not be visible to T1. So they should not affect each other. They should be executed in the isolation. Okay, they will be isolated to each other. That means while T1 is executing, T2 is not able to see the intermediate result of transaction T1. Okay, while T2 is executing, T1 should not be able to look at the intermediate operations of T2. Okay. So this is isolation. Each transaction should be isolated to each other. They should not interfere with each other. Okay, just like the process synchronization. Then we have durability. Fourth property is D, that is durability. And durability says all the operations of a successful transaction should be reflected to database even if there's a failure, even if there's any kind of failure, for example, you have a transaction T1 and it is executing like this, read A, write A, read B, write B, and then this transaction commits. When this transaction commits, we are saying that this transaction is successful. If a transaction is successful, it will finally perform the commit operation. Commit means this transaction is completed successfully. So if one transaction have committed successfully, then even if there's a failure in the database, for example, there's a power failure, there's a disk failure, let's say your database is lost, so it should be there in the database system, database management system. For example, you have a bank. In your bank you have deposited, let's say, $100,000. You have deposited $1,000,000. So after you have deposited this amount to your account and you have received the receipt, if you have received the receipt from the bank, which means your amount is being credited into your account, you get this receipt means you have successfully deposited this amount to your account. This means this should remain in the database of bank forever. If there's a failure in the bank, there's a disk failure or there's a power failure, the bank cannot say that there's a power failure in our bank and your amount is not being deposited into the account, because you have received the receipt and you have finally, if you have received the receipt, this means you have performed the commit operation on your account. For example, if you have a bank, if you have an ATM, and from the ATM you have done all the operations successfully. For example, you have entered the PIN, you have entered the amount, you got the amount, and you got the receipt. The moment you get the receipt from the ATM, this means that you have your transaction is being committed. So if there is a failure in the ATM, for example, the power goes off of the ATM, your transaction which you performed on your account will remain in the database forever. So durability says that modification made by a successful transaction should be there in the database even if there is any kind of failure. Failure can be any power failure, any hard disk failure. So these are the four properties of transaction. ACID properties. Any concurrent schedule should satisfy ACID properties. Then we can say this schedule is valid. So we can write this point. A schedule is valid only if it satisfies ACID properties. ACID properties means atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. These are the four ACID properties and they are very important properties of transactions. While you are performing the transaction, you should keep these four properties in your mind, that if you are executing a transaction, you should ask yourself, is this schedule satisfying atomicity? Is this schedule satisfying consistency, isolation, and durability? So there will be the problems in the concurrent transactions. So to ensure the ACID properties in the concurrent transactions, we will see how we can ensure these four properties. So you have ACID properties, and who is responsible for ensuring these properties? Who is responsible for ensuring the atomicity in the database? This is the work of transaction management component. So transaction management component is the part of database management system software. DBMS is a software. So transaction management component is the part of that software which will help you to ensure the atomicity. So whose responsibility is it to maintain the consistency in the database? This is the responsibility of the programmer. The programmer who is writing the SQL statements or SQL queries, or you can say while designing the database. Whoever is designing the database, it is the responsibility of the programmer to ensure the consistency of the database. Whose responsibility is it to ensure the isolation? This is the responsibility of concurrency control. component. Okay. So concurrency control component is one of the important components of the DBMS software, which we will study thoroughly after this. Whose responsibility is it to ensure the durability? So durability, ensuring the durability is the responsibility of recovery management component. So these are the different components of a DBMS software, which will ensure asset properties. Okay, so atomicity is the responsibility of transaction management component. Consistency is the responsibility of programmer. Isolation is the responsibility of concurrency control component. Durability is the responsibility of recovery management component. So they are the components of the database management system, which are responsible for different tasks. Okay, so recovery management component is one of the important part, and we will look at the concurrency control protocols. Okay, we will see some protocols in the concurrency control component which will help you to ensure the isolation. So we have covered the basics of transactions. Now we will look at the schedules. Okay, what we mean by schedule, and what is a valid schedule and what is a invalid schedule. Okay, so as we have seen the definition of schedule, a schedule is correct if it is recoverable or serializable. Okay, these are the important two words, that is serializability and recoverability, which we are going to discuss now. Okay, schedule is the combination of transactions. Okay, transactions, for example, if you look at the schedules, this is one schedule. Let's say read A, write A, read A. This is one schedule. Okay, this is serial schedule. First T1 is executing, then T2 is executing. Then schedule can be of two types, concurrent and serial schedule. Okay, this is, let's say, a concurrent schedule in which operations are in alternative way. So this is a serial schedule. And this is your concurrent schedule. Okay, this is concurrent schedule. So a schedule is correct if it is recoverable or serializable. So by these two words, now we will look at what is recoverability and what is serializability. So most of the questions in competitive examination, you will find on the recoverability and serializability. So after this lecture, you will be able to solve all kind of questions on the recoverability and serializability. So before recoverability, okay, we will start recoverability. What we mean by recoverability? In what conditions a schedule is recoverable? First, let's see in what condition schedule is not recoverable. Okay, irrecoverable schedules. Irrecoverable schedule means schedule is not recoverable. Schedule is not recoverable. In what condition schedule is not recoverable? So let's say you have a schedule in which you have two transactions, T1 and T2, and these are the operations, read A, write A, and then T2 is reading the data item A, and then there is a commit operation. Okay, T2 commits. After the commit operation of T2, let's say T1 fails. At this point, T1 is failed. What will happen in this case? If you look at this schedule closely, T2 is reading a data item A which was previously written by T1. Okay, T1 has updated the data item A, then T2 is reading this data item A. So if T1 fails, which means you have to roll back this transaction. Okay, you will roll back this transaction because there is a failure. You have to roll back this transaction because to ensure the atomicity says if there is a failure in the middle of the transaction, you should recover it, this you should roll back this transaction, because we are saying either all the operations should be executed successfully or none of the operations should be executed. So T2 is reading a data item which was previously written by T1, and the T2 is committed. if you are rollbacking T1, then you have to rollback T2 also, because T2 will be having a wrong value. Why it will be having a wrong value? Because while this is rollbacked, these modifications will be undone. Okay, these modifications will be undone. So it will, after the rollback of this T1, A will reach its initial value. Okay, so let's say if you want to look at the example, let's say the value of A was 100 before the execution of this schedule. Then T1 reads this value A 100, it will say A equals to 100. So T1 has run the read operation on the data item A. Then it will make some modification and it will finally write the value. Let's say it will do some modification 100 minus 50 and then it will write the value. That is, it will write the 50 value into the database. So T1 has written 50 into the database. This has become 50. Now T2 comes and T2 will read this value from the database, that is 50. Okay, so here T2 will read 50. But there is a failure in this T1 transaction at this point. Okay, T2 is committed. Now you have to roll back this transaction T1 because there is a failure. So while you will roll back means whatever operation you did, you have to undo all these operations. So it will undo all the operation, it will make it 100 again. Now T2 is reading the data item A, that is 50, but the actual value of A is 100. So T2 is reading a wrong value. Now you have to commit this, you have to roll back this transaction also, but you cannot roll a committed transaction. Okay, this is committed transaction. Can't roll back a committed transaction. Committed transaction means this transaction is executed successfully. If one transaction is executed successfully, why will you need to roll back it? Okay, you do not need to roll back any transaction which has been committed. So this is the case of irrecoverability. In this case, you cannot recover this schedule. Okay, you cannot recover this schedule. Why you cannot recover? You can roll back this, but you cannot roll back T2. But you have to roll back T2 because T2 is reading a wrong value. So looking at this, there's a problem. The problem is T2 is committing before the committing of T1. Okay, if T1 is successful, then T2 should commit. Okay, because T2 is reading a data item which was previously written by T1. This is the case of rollback. This is the case of irrecoverable schedule. If T2 is reading a data item written by T1, then T1 should commit first, then T2 will commit. For example, what I'm saying is, let's say you have two transactions, T1 and T2, and there's a write operation in T1, and then T2 is reading the same data item which was previously written by T1. Then T1 should commit first. If T2 commits first and then T1 commits, this schedule will be known as irrecoverable schedule. Irrecoverable schedule. Okay. As you can see, T2 depends on T1. Okay. You can see T2 depends on T1 because T2 is reading a data item which was written by T1. Same data item. Okay, you have to look at the same data item. T2 depends on T1, so T1 should commit first. T1 should commit before T2. Or you can say T2 should commit after the commit operation of T1. Okay, this will be the case of recoverability. But in this case, there's an opposite problem. T2 is depending on T1, but T2 is committing first. Okay. So what is the definition of recoverable schedules? A schedule can be sent, we can say a schedule is recoverable. So this is the definition of recoverable schedules. If T2 is reading a data item which is written by T1, then T2 should commit after T1. T2 should commit after T1. So commit operation of T1 will come first, and then T2 will commit. Then you can say this schedule is recoverable. Okay, if you are sure that T1 is successful, then you can be sure that T2 will be successful. Okay, so that's why we are putting the commit operation of T2 after T1, because T2 is depending on T1. So if there's a problem like this, so there's a condition like this, this condition is satisfied, then we can say the schedule is recoverable. Now we will see some examples how to solve the questions of recoverability. For example, you have a question like this. we have two transactions T1 and T2, and there are operations in T1, that is read A, write A, read A, read B, then read B, write B, commit, and then commit. Okay, so these are the transactions, and I have to find out whether this schedule is recoverable or not. Okay, what you can do is you can pause this video and try to solve this question by yourself by looking at the definition of recoverability. So let's see. Look at these two transactions, T1, T2, and look at the operations of T1 and T2 parallelly. So if you notice, T2 is depending on T1. Okay, you can see T2 is reading a data item which was previously written by T1. Okay, now we do not have any another dependency. Okay, the dependency should be like this, write A, read A. Okay, there should be read after write. Okay, so this then we can say this is a dependency. In this case, we can say T2 depends on, because T2 is reading a data item which was written by T1. T2 depends on T1. So obviously, if T2 depends on T1, then the commit operation of T1 should come first. So as you can see, the commit operation of T1 is coming first, then T2 is coming. So this is recoverable. This schedule is recoverable. There is no problem with this schedule. But you look at this, if you look at this schedule, this is not serializable. What we mean by serializable is, if you can draw, we will see the serializability in the detail. You can see serializability like this, T1, T2. If there is a conflicting operation, conflicting means if read, write, this is conflicting. Write, read, this is conflicting. Write, write, this is conflicting. But read A is not a conflicting operation. Okay, so these three are conflicting operations. If we have any conflicting operation between T1 and T2, we will draw a graph. In this graph, nodes will be the transactions, and we will have edges if we have any conflict between T1 and T2. If you look at this, this is the conflict between T1 and T2. So edge will go like this, T1 is conflicting with T2. Okay, T1 is conflicting with T2. Do we have any conflicting operation from T2 to T1? Yes, we have a conflicting operation in T2 to T1. So T2 is conflicting with T1. So this will be the precedence graph for these transactions. Okay, for this schedule. So if there's a cycle in the precedence graph, then we can say it is not serializable. It is not conflict serializable. So this schedule is not conflict serializable. We will see in detail what is conflict serializable in the topic serializability. Not conflict serializable, but to ensure that I will, and through this I will tell you what is the problem with recoverability. Recoverable schedules are not conflict serializable. Okay, all recoverable schedules may not be free from non-serializability. Okay, you can write this down. The problem with recoverable schedules are this. Recoverable schedules, this is important point because they have asked directly about this. Recoverable schedules may not be free from non-serializability. The schedules may be non-serializable in the recoverability. Second problem is, recoverable schedules may not be free from cascading rollback. What is called cascading rollback? From cascading rollback. We will see what is called cascading rollback. Cascading rollback means, we know what is rollback. Rollback means undoing all the operations of a transactions. Cascading rollback means failure of one transaction results rollbacking of set of other transactions. Set of other transactions. Okay. This is known as cascading rollback. For example, you have, let's say, set of transactions. Let's say we have four transactions. T1, T2, T3, T4. And we have operations like this. Write operation of A on T1. Okay. Then read A. Write A. Then we have read A. Write A. Then we have a read operation. Okay, let's say transaction T1 fails. Transaction T1 fails at this point and without committing. Before the commit operation of T1, transaction T1 fails. So if this is a failure, you have to roll back this transaction. Okay, you have to roll back this transaction. Because of rollbacking of this one, you have to roll back this one also. Why? Because T2 is depending on T1. T2 is reading a data item which was previously written by T1. A is that same data item which was written by T1. So, because if you do not roll back T2, what will happen is T2 will be reading a wrong value. Okay, it will be reading a wrong value. So, due to this, you have to roll back T2 also. Okay, because the rollback of T2, you have to roll back T3 also. Why? Because T3 is reading a data item which was previously written by T2. So, due to this, you have to roll back this transaction also. Okay, due to this, you have to roll back T4 also. So, rollbacking of one transaction is resulting in the rollback of set of other transactions. Why T4 is rollbacking? Because T4 is reading a data item which was previously written by T3. Okay, so this is the cascading rollback. We are rollbacking in cascading. Cascading means in the series. We have rollbacked one transaction T1. Due to rollbacking of T1, T2 rollbacked, T3 rollbacked and T4 rollbacked. So this is the definition saying failure of one transaction result rollbacking of set of other transactions. Okay, why you are rollbacking T2, T3, T4? Why is this case? Because T2 is reading a data item which was written by T1. T3 is reading a data item which was written by T2. So all these are dependent on each other. T2 is depending on T1, T3 is depending on T2, and T4 is depending on T3. So due to this, you have to rollback all the transactions in the cascading. So as we have seen, cascading rollback is a problem. Okay, cascading rollback is a problem. And we have a solution to this problem. The solution is we want cascade-less schedules. Cascade-less schedules. Okay, they are cascade-less recoverable. In what conditions we can say the schedule is cascade-less schedule? Cascade-less recoverable schedule. Okay, the schedule is cascade-less recoverable. Cascade-less means no cascading. No cascading. These two words may confuse you. That is cascading and cascadeless. These two words may confuse you. Cascading means a problem. Cascadeless means a solutions. So cascadeless schedule says we have put it a restriction on the transactions. We are saying that uncommitted read is not allowed. Okay, so uncommitted read is not allowed. What do you mean by uncommitted read? Let's say you have two transactions T1 and T2. T1 is writing some data item A, then T1 will commit, then only T2 can read this data item. Okay, so you are putting a restriction that if T2 is reading a data item which is written by T1, then T1 should commit first, then T2 can perform the read operations. Initially we had like this, recoverable schedules were like this, T1, T2, write A, read A, then we were saying that T1 will commit first and then T2 will commit. This is the definition of recoverability, recoverable schedules, simple recoverable schedules. Okay, in simple recoverable schedules, we were saying that if T2 is reading a data item which was written by T1, which means C2 is depending on T1, then T1 should commit first, then T2 will commit first. Now we have put it one more restriction on the cascading recoverable. Okay, CR means cascade-less recoverable. Cascade-less recoverable. Cascade-less means no cascading. So in cascade-less recoverable schedules, we are saying that uncommitted read is not allowed. This read is committed read. Committed means read mean Why this is committed read? Because T1 is writing this data item A and then it is committing. Committing means T1 has executed successfully. After the successful execution of T1, you can read the data item T2. Okay, then you can be sure that you will never read a dirty value. Okay, you will not read a any wrong value of A because T1 is committed. Now you are sure that it will not fail. Okay, so let's say we have a schedule. In this schedule, we have two transactions T1 and T2, and let's say we have a write operation. Then we have two write operations on B, write operation and read operation. Then we have write operation of B on T1. Then T2 commits, and then T1 commits after the T2. Okay, so this is a schedule. Now pause the video and try to solve this question. Tell me whether it is recoverable or not. Is this schedule recoverable? And is this schedule cascadeless recoverable? You have to find out these two things. Is this schedule recoverable? And is this schedule cascadeless recoverable? So schedule is recoverable in this condition, cascadeless recoverable in this condition. So pause the video and try to solve this question. Look at the solution. The solution is like this. You have to look at the dependencies. Okay, T1 is writing a data item A, but T2 is not reading A. T2 is reading actually B. So T2 is not reading any data item which was written by T1. So there is no dependency in these two transactions. And if you look at this, read B, write B, this is not a dependency. Dependency will be like this. If there is a write operation first, then read operation. If there is a read operation first and then write operation, there is no dependency. So obviously there is no dependencies in this schedule. So this is definitely recoverable and cascadeless recoverable because there is no dependency. None of the transactions are depending on any another transaction. No dependency means it is recoverable and it is cascadeless recoverable. The schedule is definitely recoverable. Let's say we have next example, and this example says we have two transactions T1 and T2. And there is a read operation on A, there is a read operation on B, then there is a write operation on A in transaction T1. Then T2 comes and it will perform a read operation on A. Then T1 commits and then T2 will perform a write operation and then it will finally commit. Okay, so you have to find out whether this schedule is recoverable or not, whether this schedule is cascadeless recoverable or not. Recoverable means if T2 is depending on T1, then T1 should commit first. Look at the dependencies. Yes, T2 is depending on T1. We have a read after write on the same data item. Okay, on the same data item. So T2 is depending on T1, that means T1 should commit first. Yes, T1 is committing first, then T2 is committing. So this is recoverable. The schedule is recoverable definitely. Is this schedule cascadeless recoverable? Cascadeless schedule means there should not be any uncommitted read. Uncommitted read means any read operation which is depending on T1 should be performed after the commit operation of T1. So as you can see, this read operation is uncommitted read. Uncommitted read. So the schedule is not cascadeless recoverable. The schedule is not cascadeless recoverable and the schedule is recoverable schedules. Okay. So the schedule which is cascadeless recoverable, if a schedule is cascadeless recoverable, that is definitely a recoverable schedule because we are putting more restrictions in the case of cascadeless recoverable. This schedule could have been the recoverable schedule if we have condition like this. Let's say this read operation is not here. And this read operation is after the commit operation of T1. If this read operation is at this position, okay, if we have this read operation at this position, then you can say this is committed read. This is committed read. Why this is committed read? Because this operation is after the commit operation of T1. Okay, this read is coming after the commit operation of T1, then this is committed read. But if this read operation is coming before the commit operation of T1, this read was here. because this read is coming before the commit operation of T1, then you can say this is uncommitted read. If there is an uncommitted read, that means no cascadeless recoverable. No cascadeless recoverable, then the schedule cannot be cascadeless recoverable, because cascadeless recoverable says if you have two transaction T1 and T2 and T1 is writing a data item A, then you should commit and then T2 will read. This is committed read because this read is coming after the commit operation of T1. Okay, so this is recoverable and this is not cascadeless recoverable. Then we have finally strict recoverable schedules. Strict recoverable. Okay, what we mean by strict recoverable schedules? First we had simply recoverable schedules, then we had cascadeless recoverable schedules, now we have strict recoverable schedules. In strict recoverable schedules, we are putting more restrictions. Okay, in cascadeless schedule we were saying no uncommitted read is allowed. In this strict recoverable schedule we are saying no uncommitted read or write are allowed. Okay, so we are putting more restrictions. Now we are saying uncommitted write is not even allowed. In cascadeless recoverable we are saying only no uncommitted read is allowed. Now in this strict recoverable schedule we are putting more restrictions. We are saying no uncommitted read or write is allowed. So the transactions should be in this form, that let's say this is schedule and we have two transactions T1 and T2 and T1 is writing a data item and then T1 is committing. Only after the commit operation of T1, T2 can do the read operation or write operation. Okay. Read operation or write operation of T2 should come after the commit operation of T1. Only in the case of T1, if T2 is depending on T1. Okay, if T1 is writing a data item 1. So you can write this definition, that is, if transaction T1 update data item A, then other transaction T2 not allowed read A or write A. Okay, so if T1 is updating the data item A, then T2 is not allowed to do read A or write A before the commit operation. Okay, first T1 will commit, then T2 can do the read or write operation. We will see more examples on these strict recoverable schedules and recoverable schedules, then you will understand what I am trying to say. So we have seen four kind of recoverable schedules, that is, first we have seen irrecoverable schedules. Okay, so we will have a summary, then we will solve some gate or net questions. So we have seen irrecoverable schedules and we have seen recoverable schedules. What we mean by recoverable schedules? Then we have seen cascadeless recoverable schedules and finally we have seen strict recoverable schedules. Okay, so what will be the definitions of recoverable schedules? Irrecoverable schedule will be that if you have two transactions T1 and T2, T1 was writing a data item A, then T2 is reading the same data item and T2 commit first and then T1 commits. Okay, this is the case of irrecoverable schedule. Okay, you cannot recoverable this schedule. Irrecoverable means which is not recoverable. Okay, if T2 is reading a data item T1 and T2 is committing first and T1 is committing later, then this schedule is irrecoverable schedule. Okay, to make it recoverable, we have put it a restriction. Restriction is this, that if T1 is writing a data item A and T2 is reading the same data item A, which means T2 is depending on T1, then T1 should commit first, then T2 can commit. Okay, this is the definition of recoverable schedules. What we mean by cascadeless recoverable schedules? We have put it one more restriction on the cascadeless recoverable schedules. We have two transactions T1, T2. Okay. So T1 is writing a data item A and T2 is trying to read the same data item. Okay. So this read operation of T2 should be allowed only after the commit operation of T1. Okay. This is known as committed read. Okay, this read operation is being performed after the commit operation of T1. So this is committed read. Okay, so cascadeless recoverable schedule says there should not be any uncommitted read. Then in strict recoverable schedule, we have put it one more restriction, and the restriction is this, that if T1 is writing a data item A, then and T2 is trying to perform any operation like read A or write A, this should be allowed only after the commit operation of T1. This means no uncommitted read or write is allowed. In this cascadeless schedule, we are saying no uncommitted read is allowed. Okay, no uncommitted read is allowed. In a strict recoverable schedule, we are saying no uncommitted read allowed and no uncommitted write allowed. Okay, so as you can see, we are moving and to this direction, we are putting more restrictions. So we have a gate question. In this question, it is asking, you have to find out whether this schedule is recoverable, irrecoverable or recoverable, or it is cascadeless recoverable, or it is strict recoverable. So this is the schedule, and in this schedule, we have three transactions, and these are the operations on those transactions. Okay. So what we mean by read1x, read2z, read1z, and read3x? This means that we have operation readx on the transaction T1. Okay. We have a read operation on z, that is in transaction T2. So like this, we have three transactions. If we write this in the normal form, in the simple form will be like this. We have three transactions, T1, T2, T3. Okay, R1X means read operation of X in the transaction T1. Then R2Z, R2Z means read Z in the transaction T2. R1Z means read operation on Z in the transaction T1. R3X means read operation on X in the transaction T3. Then R3Y, which means read operation on Y in the transaction T3. Then write1X, which means in the T1 transaction. Write3Y means in the T3 transaction. Read2Y means in the T1 transaction. Okay, readY. Then we have writeZ. Write2Z means write operation on Z in the transaction T2. Okay, then we have W2Y, that is WY on the transaction T2. Then we have commit operation. Okay, this is C1, C2, C3 means commit operation on transaction T1. Then commit operation of transaction T2, commit operation of transaction T3. So first T1 is committing, then T2 is committing, then T3 is committing. Okay, these are the commit operation. This is the order of committing operations. So we have to find out whether this schedule is irrecoverable, recoverable, or cascadeless recoverable, or strict recoverable. So you have to look at the dependencies. So till now, till here, we do not have any problem. Okay, why we do not have any problem? Because there is no write operation in this. Okay, dependency will be only when there is a write operation. So as you can see, In this operation, there is no problem. This is write operation on X. This is write operation on Y. So now here in T3, we are writing a data item Y, which is being read by T1. So you can say T1 is depending on T3. Okay, T1 is depending on T3, which means the commit operation of T3 should come first. As you can see here, T1 depends on T3. Okay, because T1 is reading a data item which is written by T3. So according to the definition of recoverable schedules, the commit operation of T1 should, the commit operation of T3 should come first. Okay, T3 should commit first. But if you look at the commit operations, T3 is committing after T1. Okay, T3 is committing after T1. So the schedule is not recoverable, which means schedule is irrecoverable schedule. Okay, the schedule is irrecoverable. Why? Because T1 is depending on T3. So if T1 is depending on T3, according to recoverable schedules, definition of recoverable schedules, the commit operation of T3 should come first, but the commit operation of T3 is coming after T1. Okay, as you can see from here. So the schedule is irrecoverable schedule. That is option A is correct. So now we have next question, and the question is same. We have a schedule, and in this schedule we have transactions and operations, and we have to find out whether this schedule is recoverable or but not cascadeless recoverable, or it is strict recoverable. So if you write this schedule, it will be like this. We have three transactions, T1, T2 and T3. R1x means read operation of x in transaction T1. Okay, R2z means read operation of z in the transaction T2. Okay, this is representing the transaction number. Okay, then R3x, that is read operation in the transaction T3. Then we have RZ, then we have R2Y, R3Y, then we have write one X. Okay, then C1. C1 means commit operation of C1. So now commit. Okay, T1 is committing at this position. C1 means commit operation of transaction T1. Then we have write Z. Then we have W3Y, that means write operation of Y in the transaction T3. Then we have W2Y. W2Y means write operation of Y in the transaction T2. Then we have commit operation of C3. And after C3, we are committing C2. Okay, C2 is committing after C3. So like this, we have these transactions and these are the operations. We have to find out whether these transactions are recoverable or cascadeless recoverable or strict recoverable. Okay, so these are the read operations, and there is no problem if we have only read operations. Okay, we do not have any problem, we have only read operations. The problem is because of write operations. So now we have this write operation, write x. So W is writing a data item x, and then we do not have any dependencies in this T2 and T3 because we do not have any use of X and T2 or in T3. Okay, so there is no problem. Now look at the dependencies in T2 and T3. T1 has completed. So T2, T3, I think we do not have any dependency because this is writing data item Y and this is also doing the write operation. If this was read operation, then there will be dependency because in this write, there is no dependency. Dependency is only when we have write and read. Okay, so there are no dependencies in this. Okay, so there is no dependency, which means it is definitely recoverable schedule. But we have to find out for cascadeless recoverable and strict. Okay, we have to find out for all these conditions: recoverable, cascadeless recoverable and strict. So this is satisfying the definition of recoverable schedule. There is no dependency. Cascadeless recoverable set, there is no uncommitted read is allowed. So as you can see, there is no uncommitted read. Uncommitted read means if T1 is writing a data item X, there should not be any read operation before the commit operation of T1. Okay, there is no read operation in T2, T3. This is definitely cascadeless recoverable. Okay, this is recoverable and cascadeless recoverable also. Now look at the strict recoverable. Strict recoverable schedule says if you are doing a write operation on a data item, then another transaction is not allowed to read or write. Okay, strict says this: no uncommitted read or write allowed. No uncommitted read write allowed. So as you can see, this is writing a data item Z. So no uncommitted read or write on Z should be allowed. So there is no problem. Now there is a problem here. T3 is writing a data item Y. So now another transactions, that is T1, T2, is not allowed to do read or write before the commit operation of this. But as you can see, this is uncommitted write. Okay, this is uncommitted write because this is coming before the commit operation of T3. Okay, this situation is like this. Let's say this is T2, T3. I'm taking only this part. Okay, I'm taking this part. The problem is like this. and then we have commit of T3, then we have commit of T2. So strict recoverable schedule says if one transaction is doing the write operation on a data item, then another transaction is not allowed to read or write before the commit, but it is doing the write operation before commit operation of T3. So this is not strict recoverable. Okay, this is not strict recoverable. This is recoverable. This is cascadeless recoverable, but it is not strict recoverable. So the correct option is it is irrecoverable. No. Recoverable but not cascadeless recoverable? No, because this is cascadeless recoverable. This is cascadeless recoverable but not strict. This is okay. This schedule is cascadeless recoverable but not strict. Okay, so D is wrong. So C is the right answer for this question. So now I have this schedule and I have to find out whether this is recoverable or cascadeless recoverable or strict recoverable. Okay, so let's see. We have only two transactions in this schedule and these three transactions are like this. Okay, let's say we have two transactions, T1 and T2. Okay, these are the two transactions. R1A means read A, W1A means write A, then read B, write B, then we have write B. Then we have write A, read A on T2. Then we have commit operation of T1 and then commit operation of T2. Okay, C2 means commit operation of T2, C1 means commit operation of T1. So now I have to find whether this is recoverable or cascadeless recoverable or strict recoverable. Okay, so let's look at the recoverable first. Is this schedule recoverable? Or what you can do is you can directly check for strict recoverable. If a schedule is strict recoverable, then it is definitely cascadeless and recoverable. Okay, so you can go like this or you can go from top to bottom. If it is strict recoverable schedule, then definitely it is cascadeless and it is recoverable. If it is not a strict recoverable schedule, then you have to check for cascadeless recoverable and recoverable. So as you can see, T1 is writing a data item A. And then T2 is reading the same data item A. Okay, but as you can see, T2 is reading this data item A, which is previously written by the same transaction. Okay, same transaction. So this is not dependency. You cannot say T2 is depending on T1 because the definition of recoverable schedule is this. If T2 is reading a data item A, which was previously written by another transaction, then there's a dependency, but this is not a dependency because T2 is reading a data item A, which was previously written by same transaction T2. Okay, so there is no dependency. So if we look at more, okay, we have missed something here. Okay, this write A operation is actually in the T1. Okay, this write operation is in T1. This write 1A. Okay, so this is write A. Read A, write A, read B, write B, then write B, then write A in the T1 transaction, then read to A. So then T1 is committing, then T2 is committing. So in this case, you can see T2 is depending on T1. Okay, T2 is definitely depending on T1 because T2 is reading a data item A, which was previously written by T1. So this is that, this is T2 depends on T1. So according to the definition of recoverability, T1 should commit first. Okay, T1 should commit first. This is okay. T1 is committing before the commit operation of T2. So this is recoverable. Okay, this is recoverable. Is this cascadeless recoverable? No, it is not cascadeless recoverable because this read operation is uncommitted read. This is uncommitted read. So definitely, if a schedule is not cascadeless recoverable, then it is not strict recoverable. Okay, it is not strict recoverable schedule. So it is uncommitted read. Okay, why this is uncommitted read? Because this is reading the data item A before the commit operation of T1. Cascadeless recoverable schedule says if T2 is reading a data item written by T1, then T1 should commit first, then only T2 can read. Okay, T2 cannot read before the commit operation, but T2 is reading before the commit operation of T1. So this is recoverable, but it is not strict recoverable and it is not cascadeless recoverable. In next question, we have two transactions and I have to find out whether this is recoverable or it is cascadeless recoverable or it is strict recoverable. Okay, look at the recoverable schedule first. As you can see, T1 is writing a data item A and then T2 is reading. But the problem is T2 is actually reading this data item A, which was previously written by itself. Okay, T2. So this is not a dependency. This is definitely recoverable schedule. Okay, there is no dependency in this schedule. No dependency. As you can see, T1 is reading a data item A, then T1 is writing the same data item. Okay, dependency is only when T2 is reading a data item which was previously written by T1. But T2 is definitely reading a data item A, but it is not previously written by T1. It is previously written by itself. Okay, same transaction. Is this cascadeless recoverable? Is this cascadeless recoverable? Cascadeless recoverable says means no uncommitted read is allowed. Okay, this is definitely uncommitted read. Okay, this is not uncommitted read. Why this is not uncommitted read? Because uncommitted read means, what we mean by uncommitted read? Okay, do not take it wrongly. Okay, this is not an uncommitted read. The condition for uncommitted read is like this. Commit. When T2 is reading a data item which was previously written by T1, then you can say this is reading data item A, which is committed, okay, which is not still committed. Okay, this is reading before the commit operation of T1. Okay, this is committing before the commit operation of this is reading the data item A before the commit operation of T1. This is uncommitted read. Okay, this is uncommitted read. But if you have something like this, let's say T1 and T2, and this is writing a data item A, then it is doing the write operation and then it is doing the read operation, and we are doing commit operation of T1 and then commit operation. Okay, this read is actually coming before the commit operation of T1, but it is not uncommitted read. Why it is not an uncommitted read? Because it is reading the same data item which was written by same transaction T2. Okay, this is not an uncommitted read. Not a uncommitted read. Okay, the same situation is here. So this read A is not an uncommitted read. So this is cascadeless recoverable schedule. Now strict says no uncommitted read or write allowed. Okay, so T1 is writing the data item A, then T2 is not allowed to do read or write on the same data item before the commit operation of T1. The commit operation of T1 is here, but before this T2 is writing the data item A. Okay, so this is uncommitted write. This is uncommitted write. Due to this, this schedule is not a strict recoverable schedule. So this schedule is recoverable and cascadeless recoverable, but not strict. But not strict. So we have completed recoverability, and if we look at the summary of recoverability, we have seen irrecoverable schedules, we have seen recoverable schedules, then we have seen cascadeless recoverable schedules, and then we have seen strict recoverable schedules. Okay, if you see them as a subsets and sets, you will find that, okay, you will find that we have schedules like this. All the schedules can be categorized in this form. Strict recoverable schedules are most restricted schedules. Okay, in this we have strict recoverable schedules. Okay, then we have cascadeless recoverable schedules, and then we have recoverable schedules. And then we have all irrecoverable schedules. Okay, so you can say that all strict recoverable schedules are cascadeless schedule, recoverable schedules. Okay, or you can say all recoverable schedules are not cascadeless and not strict. Okay, if any schedule is cascadeless, then it may be strict or may not be strict. Okay, for example, if you have a schedule at this position, then this schedule is cascadeless, recoverable, but not strict. Okay, but if it is cascadeless, then definitely this is recoverable schedule. This is recoverable schedules. So these schedules are irrecoverable schedules. At this position, we have irrecoverable schedules. Okay, if a schedule is irrecoverable, then definitely it cannot be recoverable schedule, it cannot be cascadeless, and it cannot be strict. Okay, so if a schedule is strict recoverable schedule, then it is cascadeless recoverable also, and it is recoverable also. Okay, if a schedule is cascadeless recoverable, then it is not, it may not be strict recoverable, but it is definitely recoverable schedule, because cascadeless recoverable schedules are subset of recoverable schedules. Okay, we have some schedules which are recoverable but not cascadeless recoverable, and then we have some schedules which are cascadeless recoverable schedules but not strict recoverable schedules. Okay, so this is recoverability. Now we will start serializability.